But dear friends, before I start, I must say that this group is very, very sticky with their applause. You know, the last group, the panel, spoke so well. They had such nice insights. But you know, you were so confused with your Tanya. Give them a Tanya. So I'm just going to, you know, keep it very short. This whole event is called Women in Power, and frankly, I'm a big believer in that particular statement. Must mention that I belong to a field, the information technology field, where women are one of the most important resources, and so we really don't appreciate or understand the difference between men and women in terms of, you know, delivering performance, taking targets, and really performing to very high level goals. So first of all, I must say that, you know, whether it is global economic growth, community development, organizational revenue, productivity, any kind of metric that you look at, women's power and the impact that they make there is completely undeniable. But the tragedy and the truth in all of this is that they speak different languages, these statistics. If you look at the 2018 Global Gender Gap Report by the World Economic Forum, it says only 68% of this gender gap has actually been closed, you know, in spite of all that we have spoken about. At the current rate, guess how many years it is going to take for the gender gap to close? Any guesses in the audience? 108 years, right? Now, do you really want to wait that long? I would say no, and that has to be a resounding answer. And the reason for this is because women frankly make up half the Earth's population, right? They are one of the most enabling powers of mankind, and to fritter away the advantage that we have, having this wonderful talent base around us, is an absolute crime if you ask me. And in order to build a flourishing community, a flourishing world, and a global kind of mindset, the ability to actually access that, you know, the talent and leverage them is something that is critical for the world, I would say. Let me give you some statistics to help you appreciate why, in spite of all the talk, there hasn't been enough. And every single leader who actually walks the talk and delivers even a little, you know, on this front, actually is making a difference. Statistics say that there is a potential of an additional $4.5 trillion economy possible in Asia Pac just by allowing women an equal opportunity in the workplace. $4.5 trillion potential. India, if you ask me, has the largest opportunity in that 4.5 trillion. And more than 70% increase in the impact by women is possible by just adding 10% more to the workforce. Just think of those statistics, right? I'm sorry if some of the men here feel a little ashamed because of it, but don't worry, you guys can also catch up. Now let us look at business as a workforce. More than technology, in my view, it is talent that is actually going to drive the next level of growth in terms of the fourth industrial revolution. But again, if you look at the statistics, we have a lot to still, you know, build on. Only 25% of India's labor force today is women. Only 25%. And women's contribution in India to the GDP is only 18% at this point in time. Now some of us can be negative about this, but for me, I actually see this as such a big opportunity. You know, if we can just take the steps to ensure that talent is available to us, this India, this world will be such a different place. And what is the reason? some of this. Because while in the big cities, the metros, we see much more of a positive mindset. If you look into the, you know, semi-urban and the urban areas, the issues are all around lack of education, lack of basic sanitation, the digital divide, and the social kind of morals that are actually enabling the same old mindset to continue. So I would say we need to really change that. The other thing I would say, which we have to kill, is the gender pay gap. Just to give you a sense, even in the US today, women earn only 0.79% of what men earn, right? And based on what I've been telling you all this while, they are delivering as much, if not more, right? And therefore, it is an absolutely important stated objective that we change that. The business I belong to and the industry I work with is represented by NASSCOM. I happen to chair NASSCOM, as Romy said, and NASSCOM today delivers $181 billion to India's economy, 7.9% of India's GDP. But let me tell you, we have enabled, and I don't say this as enablement, because we have actually been very smart in terms of appreciating, you know, the talent potential and just leveraging this talent in terms of very interesting models. 45% of the people who work in the IT industry in India are women. And our objective is, how do we get it to 50 or beyond? So if you ask me how I spend my time, I spend a lot of time with the government, with the IT minister, the prime minister and the others, in terms of models like work from home, enabling people coming out of, you know, pregnancy, things like that, to really re-engage with the workforce, but not in a model where they need to come to the office. So a lot of interesting things happen there. Our leadership pipeline is extremely strong. For those of you who may not be aware, the president of NASSCOM is a woman. Dev Jani Ghosh, the former CEO of Intel, and somebody who, you know, inspires me every day in terms of her passion, her energy, the things that she does. We focus a lot on creating an ethical and a safe workplace, right? Very important for both the genders in order to feel safe when they come to work and appreciate, understand what is available to them, what are the rules of engagement, and how they can, you know, produce during those 8 hours they engage. We focus a lot on skilling and upskilling. At this point in time, one of the biggest initiatives we are driving from NASSCOM under my chairmanship is what is called the Future Skilling Initiative that will skill 4 billion technology workers, 50% of whom are women. We run something called NASSCOM's Women Research Rural Tech, right? It's called W2RP, NASSCOM Women's Research Rural Tech. So we're making it very clear that they rule tech more than any man or any group of men could. Similarly, at a company I run at WNS, we are extremely, you know, fortunate that, again, we have a very diversified and diverse work, you know, kind of group. 45% of my employees are women. But in spite of that, the challenge is how do we build more women leaders at the senior most levels? So we run a very interesting program over the last 2 years called Project Centurion. My focus is how do we elevate 100 outstanding women leaders as the future leaders of this company. At this point in time, we have identified 30 leaders. We're working on a 2-year program which involves the whole of, you know, the leadership of WNS, but we also are working with IIM, Ahmedabad, and the Harvard Business School. It's a very structured program driven directly from my office. At the same time, the advantage we give some of these people are accelerated learning curves and projects that will help them get to the next level faster. Look, I must tell you, I have been inspired by women all my life, and just to give you a sense. So I really find it very difficult to appreciate the difference, right? My mother was the first manager of the Indian women's cricket team. So I've grown up in 1970s, you know, when I was like 10 years old, going around with her, you know, across the whole country, hosting, you know, the Indian team, a lot of Australia or England, or, you know, a lot of West Indies, carrying bags for them. So I know Susha Shah, I know Shanta Ramaswamy, I know Diana, you know, all these people who today are big shots, but who at that time were youngsters. And my mom used to sit right next to Indira Gandhi and do this. My sister has been the first captain of the Indian, you know, handball team as well. So again, someone who, you know, constantly inspires me. I spoke to you about the Keshav Murugesh, the president of NASSCOM. He handpicked her and made her the president and made her, you know, actually quit the last job that she had with a very well-known company because we felt she could lead NASSCOM and India to the next level of growth. My own wife shocked me. In fact, when this invitation came, it didn't come for me. This invitation was sent to my wife, Shamini, who actually is the, you know, honorary chief member of WMS Cares Foundation. And the only reason that she is not here is because she's acquired one more degree. She's already an MS in economics and econometrics, but this morning she again left for Oxford because she's just completing, you know, one more master's program in organizational leadership. So I told Romy that, hey, Shamini is not going to be here. But the reason she was invited is because she has created for WMS, the company I run, a very unique kind of CSR initiative that today impacts 125,000 children across the globe. And the new cybersecurity initiative that she has launched for kids through WMS Cares Foundation is now already impacting 1.3 million children across the world. And very soon it will be, you know, multiples of that because governments are getting involved in terms of getting involved with us. So for me, I must say, you know, I'm very inspired by women, and it is not the people who are not adopted. We were inspired by Mother Teresa, we were inspired by so many others. But people around us, people we work with, people we meet every day, these are the inspirations, you know, for us that we should focus on. I want to end by saying that, you know, how should we address this lack of access? I think the first is we need to shift attitudes about women's role in society and work. You know, we spoke a little about it. I have lots of notes on it, but, you know, I think we should all assume that there's a lot that needs to be done in that particular area. And in fact, I just say one thing. The McKinsey report said, you know, that 71% in India agreed with the World Value Survey statement, when a mother works for pay, the children suffer. Think of that. Right? So that's something we need to change. The second is just enabling better childcare in offices, in the workplace. I think it's a very important thing. Strong gender neutral leave and vacation policies. I think we've seen a lot of that happen all over the world, in India as well. We've got to push that. The second I would say is needing to improve women's access to digital technology. I think that is going to empower them significantly, particularly in the urban and semi-urban, you know, kind of areas. And we have to address the fact that there is underrepresentation of women in senior leadership positions. No more should we accept, you know, being patted on the back for having a few women here and there. There have to be structured programs. Because the issue is not about representation at every level. The issue is representation at the senior most level, right? We have to work on that. And it is not cool to look at women for only certain kinds of roles. I think many of you appreciate what I'm saying, right? It is not cool. They are capable of doing anything better than any one of us. The third I would say is equal pay, equal rights, and equal opportunity must be driven. And women must be coached for leadership positions through structured programs. So this is no more a women's issue, if you ask me. This is a leadership issue. This is an issue of how we are going to transform India and the world through structured thinking. I will end by just, you know, reminding all of us what Margaret Thatcher said. She said, if you want something to be said, give it to a man. If you want something to be done, give it to a woman. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Keshav Murugesh, CEO NASSCOM. We want to.